Utah is a really good team. I'm not saying they're not. But can we? This is where I just want to expedite and get to the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Like, it's fine. The body of work is incredible. Mm-hmm. Are they the real deal? Potentially. But until I see it in the playoffs, I don't know if I'm a believer of it.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm a believer. 17-2
at home.
Yes.
Always a tough home team, Utah is. They always have been. That's historic for, you know, historically for them, that's what it is. But I had to laugh because, like, you know, Donovan Mitchell's like, you know, we showed good fortitude in this game.
Like,
dude,
what?
You beat a G League team.
Nobody was on the court.
Dial it down a little bit.
They be flexing, though, too. And that's usually what you do. Like, you know, they're not going to know what it looks like to go against, you know, the big three and the matchups and all that type of stuff. So it's false confidence. And they better keep it in perspective and understand that, listen, they just got a victory. It's not against the team that they're going to see. But listen, they're not going to see each other unless it's the championship anyway.
Exactly.
And
what are the chances they do?
Right. Just the likelihood of that.
You just dismissed it.
I did.
The look on your face tells me it's zero. The likelihood is zero.
I don't think they're ready for the prime time, man. I understand, you know, that they're the best team, but, you know, they're putting a lot of energy, I believe, into trying to get the best record. You know, when the good teams understand that it doesn't really matter because the matchups, it doesn't matter who they play. The Lakers aren't concerned where they're going to be seated. I don't think Brooklyn's concerned where they're going to be seated because I know they understand that the cream rises to the top and it's going to start rising to the top pretty soon. And we'll see. You know, we'll separate the men from the boys in the playoffs. And, you know, I understand that it's more important for Utah to have that continuity and confidence and look at the record and feel better about themselves because of what happened to them last year. Say, hey, we're going to learn from that experience. We're going to get over the hump.
Well, they have been playing extremely well. Look, Jordan Clarkson was my sixth man of the year thus far in midseason awards, right? Donovan Mitchell, we all heard that little spat he had with Shaq, which was awkward, right? Yeah. But I think he's risen to the challenge. I mean, they have the pieces in place to be dangerous. But, like, you know, they couldn't have seen the Lakers in the Western Conference semifinals depending upon seedings. So, like, there's – and the question is, are the Lakers going to be healthy? What is going on with the Clippers? But, like, with all these other variables that are factoring in, I want to see where teams are towards the end of the season, who's healthy and who isn't.
Well, Jay Weezy, who needs to make a bigger splash or attempt at bringing in a star to get them over the hump? I always go back and take it back to my circle, right? And I always go back to the year when the Pistons brought in Rasheed Wallace and when he was just that – finishing piece that put them over the top, that made them a championship contender. Who out there needs to make a move for a player that can potentially put them over the hump that we're not looking at as one of the favorites right now?
I really wish that he would be open for it. But if the Denver Nuggets found a way to use Michael Porter Jr. and other assets to get Bradley Beal, can you imagine that trio of Bradley Beal, Jamal Murray, and Nikola Jokic? Our new nickname that we've given him on our show due to our producer, the Eggman, like the Jokic, the Eggman.
I like that.
If you were to give him that star along with Jamal Murray, I think that would put Denver in that top tier conversation.
Right now, and they're sort of that team that they, like, again, they got smoked last night. Like, they're a team that's just weird how they
can't
have
be my,
been.
They're fifth in the Western Conference, but that's why I don't have Jokic as my MVP. And I understand that Vegas has him as the odds favorite, but I look at him like, no, you got to be top two. Top three in your conference. I can't see that yet.
Yeah, and that's exactly what it is. We're showing it right now. The best odds to win NBA MVP. Now, since the injuries to Embiid and LeBron James, you have Jokic now as the favorite, -110. Then it's LeBron +550. Embiid at +600. Giannis at +650. James Harden at +900.
How is that possible?
I got Giannis fatigue.
Now, that's the question, I think, also, is that James Harden, what he's done in his 30 games with the Nets, and I've said this, and then everybody in Houston got so upset about it. They got tight when I said this, but I'm not the only one that says it. James Harden in a Nets uniform is a far more entertaining player, a more watchable player, and a completely different player than what he was in Houston, where he was more of the ISO player, where he did pass, of course, but it was off of what he was doing. A lot of the martial arts as well with him and trying to draw fouls and all the flopping that he did.
Steve Zagal.
With Brooklyn, a much different player, a facilitator, a guy that certainly, even without the other two stars in the lineup, the Nets still won because of James Harden. So with that in mind, considering where they are in the standings as well, shouldn't he be more of in the conversation for MVP? So we had Greeny on yesterday, and he was telling us about how he's going to have Charles Barkley on his show, which he did. And you know, Barkley doesn't come on a show and not say anything. He usually has something to say. And when you preface it with, I know I'm going to take a lot of heat for this, you know it's something pretty strong. So not only does he feel like James Harden should be an MVP candidate, he took it a step further when he talked to Greeny. Listen.
I know I'm going to probably get criticized for saying this. this guy might be the best basketball player in the world. I mean, he might be the best player in the world. I've always thought he was the best offensive player. He wasn't as great as Michael and Kobe. But I said a few years ago, and people laughed at me, he's the best offensive player I've ever seen. Mm. But right now, no disrespect to LeBron or Giannis or anybody, James Harden might be the best basketball player in the world, period.
Is he wrong? Is he right? Is it a crazy take?
No, it's not crazy. And look, people are going to say, well, Jay, you're a Nets fan. Yeah, where were you listening to me like 5 years ago, mm-hmm. 6 years ago? Like 10 years before that, I was dragging the Nets all the time. Always dragging the Nets. But this dude is different. Multiple 40-point triple-doubles in his resume. The fact that no player has ever won MVP after being traded in the same year. And he is going to do that. He is the most innovative one-on-one player in the history of the game. That says a lot.
Yes.
When you're talking about guys like AI.
The most innovative?
Guys like, yeah. I mean, I've never seen the sidestep, yeah. the step
yeah.
back, the strength that he's had.
He created the move, yeah.
He's built damn near like Bart.
Yeah, man.
On the basketball court, but has touch and can shoot from half court mm-hmm. and yeah. can get to the free throw line whenever
Steph
he
Curry.
Wants.
He and Steph Curry are two guys that have changed the game, would you say?
Yes, but here's what I will say about James Harden. Like, I feel like a lot of people try to emulate Steph Curry, even though Steph Curry is 6'3", 6'4", yeah. right? But that frame, it seems like it's more yeah. conducive to fans. You can't emulate James Harden. You can't have the
strong
frame,
yeah.
the strength. He's 225 pounds, yeah. man. He can bulldoze through you or he can dance around you. Like, people don't have feet or the body size to play that way.